What would I have done? It's a central question in the student of history's imagination when confronted by the horrors of the Holocaust. Today's guest delves deep into the experience of one town in Ukraine changed forever by genocide. He's Omer Bartov, this week on Story in the Public Square. Hello and welcome to Story in the Public Square, where storytelling meets public affairs. I'm Jim Lutis from the Pell Center at Salve Regina University, and alongside me is my friend and co-host G. Wayne Miller from the Providence Journal. Each week we explore the role that storytelling, including history, plays in America's public life. This week we're joined by a talented and accomplished historian and author. Omer Bartov is the John P. Birkeland Distinguished Professor of European History at Brown University and the author of a new book, Anatomy of a Genocide, the Life and Death of a Town Called Buchach. Omer, thank you so much for being with us.
Thank you for having me.
So your scholarship has focused on a wide array of issues, focusing on war, on genocide, not the lightest of topics. What drew you to these topics as a scholar?
There's no one simple answer, but I grew up in Israel. In the 1950s and 60s, I grew up surrounded by many people who were survivors of the Holocaust. When I was seven, the Eichmann trial took place in Israel, and I remember as a child listening to it being broadcast every evening on the radio. We'd all sit on our porches, have supper, and listen to these events. So somehow it was very much part of my childhood. And later on, I became increasingly interested in war. I was a soldier myself for 4 years, and I became interested in the question of motivation, of what makes soldiers fight, and what makes soldiers commit crimes. And that was a question that took me to really to my PhD, to the first issues that I tried to confront as a scholar. Mm.
Your new book, Anatomy of a Genocide, The Life and Death of a Town Called Buchach, is you described it to us in the before we started today as trying to get to the heart of what happens to soldiers on the ground that commit these atrocities. Talk to us a little bit about the book and what you were trying to explore.
So the first question that I had is I had studied genocide before. Genocide is often being studied from the top. From the point of view of the perpetrators, how was it organized? How do you organize the mass destruction of a group? And one of the ideas about explaining that was that you have to dehumanize people, that you have to think of them as different from us, as not normal. And I thought that was in part true. But I wanted to see what happens on the ground, what happens when perpetrators come to a certain town and actually start killing the people there. These were not soldiers, they were policemen who arrived in this town. And my question was, do they interact with the people they kill before they kill them? Do they know them? So I started off with that question. When I started studying the specific town, I realized that it was important to understand not only the relationship between the perpetrators and the victims, but also the other people who lived there. And that if you want to understand the dynamics of a local genocide, you have to understand what were the social dynamics between the different groups that had lived there before the perpetrators came, because that determines the nature of the event itself.
Mm. So Anatomy of a Genocide has also a very personal element to it. And I'm hoping you can talk about that. I mean, you have one of your previous books is Murder in Our Midst, and you wrote A Race, which covers the same themes, but there's something more intimate and family related here. And I'll let you speak now.
So when I thought of the idea of studying one town and seeing what happened there, I had to choose a town, and it was clear to me that it would be a town, if it had to do with the Holocaust, that would be in Eastern Europe, because that's where most of the Jews lived and that's where most of the Jews were murdered. But which town would I choose? There were hundreds of them. And there was one town that I thought could be interesting to me, and there were two reasons for it. One was that it's the town from which a very well-known Hebrew language author came, and I had read his stories when I was in high school in Israel. He's the only author to have received the Nobel Prize in Literature. His name is Agnon. The other reason was that my mother came from that town. And I'd never actually asked her anything about her childhood there. She came in 1935 with her parents and two brothers, and she never spoke about that past. And so in 1995, I decided to interview her and to ask her about her childhood. And once she talked about it, I thought, well, this is the town that I'm now going to study and see what happened there after she left.
Did she ever, once you started writing this book, talk to you more about her childhood? I mean, this was an extraordinary childhood under very difficult circumstances.
Well, she left in 1935, so she was 11 then. And that time that I interviewed her, I turned on a tape recorder. I said, Mother, can you speak about your childhood? And she spoke for an hour and a half. She had the whole story ready, but she had never been asked.
Wow.
And it was a fascinating story, but it was not a story of anti-Semitism or fear. It was a story of a childhood, and a nice childhood. She went to a Polish school. She spoke Ukrainian on the street. She spoke Yiddish at home. She had very fond memories of her childhood. But they left 4 years before World War II. She didn't, after we spoke, she said, maybe we should go and visit, because she had not been there since 1935. Mm. And by then she was in her early 70s. And I said, yes, let's plan it. But not long thereafter, she fell ill. And in 1998, she passed away. So we never went together. And she only saw the very beginnings of my research.
So for our readers, for our audience, what happened in Buchach?
So what happened in Buchach was that in 1939, this area in which Buchach is located, it's now Western Ukraine, at the time it was Eastern Poland, was annexed by the Soviet Union. This was part of the agreement, the Molotov-Ribbentrop agreement between the Soviet Union and Nazi Germany. So that area came under the Soviet Union between 1939 and 1941. The Soviets had their own policies, which had to do a great deal with deporting unwanted groups, and elites. So they deported many Poles, then they deported many Jews, and then they imprisoned and deported many Ukrainians. In 1941, the Germans arrived. This was the German attack on the Soviet Union. Between the fall, summer fall of 1941 and summer fall of 1942, there was violence there, but mass killing hadn't started. The mass killing begins in the late summer, early fall of 1942, and by spring 1943, most of the Jewish population in that town has been murdered, about 10,000 people. So by June 1943, this area is declared by the Germans Judenrein, clean of Jews. And after that, much of the violence that occurs there is either hunting down Jews who are still hiding in forests or in villages or inside the town, or violence between Polish nationalists and Ukrainian nationalists, because the Ukrainian nationalists are trying to create a Pole-free and Jew-free Ukraine. So that by 1944, this area has basically become purely Ukrainian.
Who did the killing?
The killing of the Jews is done primarily by about 20 to 30 Germans who are members of the security police. Who 20 to 30 Germans.
Killed 10,000 Jews over the course of a couple of years.
They killed 60,000 Jews in that area. They are in charge of an area in which Buchach is one of the larger towns. There's one other large town, Chotkov. They're based in that other town. And every once in a while, they come and they kill as many Jews as they can catch. However, they obviously cannot do that alone. And so what they have are police forces that they have formed that help them round people up and often also kill them. They have a Ukrainian police battalion that numbers about 300 men, and then in each town they have Ukrainian police, German police, and Jewish police who help them round up people, lead them to the pits, and then they shoot them there.
So some of these people were people who had lived for centuries peacefully, relatively peacefully coexisting. So what happens in the minds of people that, with a tradition of peaceful, mostly peaceful coexistence, to rounding up neighbors, friends, people they know, to be brought off to be executed? What happened?
So, you know, this was exactly the issue that exercised me, because as I said initially, I wanted to know what is the relationship between the perpetrators and the victims. But it turns out there were many people there who were not, strictly speaking, the perpetrators, the German, and not, strictly speaking, the victims, the Jewish victims of the Holocaust. They were all the neighbors. Now, these people had lived side by side for about four centuries. Jews, Poles, and Ukrainians had lived side by side. I wouldn't say it was a harmonious coexistence, but they lived together, and they did not know any other reality. This was what they had always done.
They didn't have gangs and killing squads or anything like
that? No.
And I mean, they had the differences, but they lived together.
And from the 17th century was very violent and brutal, but from 1700 on, they lived side by side quite peacefully, and they often speak each other's languages. They go to school together. They pray in different prayer houses. They are distinct by their religions. From the late 19th century, with the rise of nationalism, these groups start thinking about each other differently from the way they thought about each other before. That is, they start thinking who belongs to this place and who doesn't. The Ukrainians say they've been colonized by the Poles. The Poles say that they brought civilization to these savage areas. And the Jews don't claim that this belongs to them, but they claim that they built the towns, that they brought commerce there, that they are part of the fabric of that society. That discourse, which until World War I is still quite, it's only verbal, turns into violence during World War I, which is extremely violent there, and its immediate aftermath when that area is annexed by the Poles. And the Ukrainian freedom movement there, which wants this area to become part of independent Ukraine, continues fighting against the Poles throughout the 1920s and 1930s. And the Polish government, by the middle of the 1930s, also becomes increasingly anti-Semitic. And so what you have by the time the Soviets come is three groups that have already a history of both violent discourse against each other and also a fair amount of actual killing and violence, particularly in the immediate aftermath of World War I. That's the background on which we have to understand what the Germans do when they come in.
We need to take a quick moment for station identification. This is Story in the Public Square, where storytelling meets public affairs. Three times every weekend, you can catch this show on Sirius XM Satellite Radio's popular Politics of the United States. That's the POTUS channel, 124. We produce Story in the Public Square with a tremendous team of professionals at Rhode Island PBS. I'm Jim Lutis from the Pell Center for International Relations and Public Policy at Salve Regina University. You can find me on Twitter at JM Lutis. My co-host is the multi-talented filmmaker, author, and journalist G. Wayne Miller of the Providence Journal. You can catch up with Wayne at G. Wayne Miller. And our guest this week is Omer Bartov, a professor of European history and German studies at Brown University. He's also the author of a powerful new history, Anatomy of a Genocide, The Life and Death of a Town Called Buchach. Omer, I am listening to this conversation, and I'm reminded of a phrase that my mother used once about the veneer of civilization being awfully thin. Was my mom right?
It is curious that you say that, because I just wrote these words in an essay that I wrote, precisely these words, the veneer of civilization, and I think that your mother had a very strong point. What you find in any place, in any town, in any neighborhood, Whether it is in Eastern Europe, and we think of that as very fine, very different, or it's in your own neighborhood in the United States, or in Israel, or in Germany, or in Britain, you find that if you succeed in telling groups that in diverse societies that they are different, that they have different rights, that they have different claims on humanity, and then you have a government that decides to target one of those groups, then it would be very easy, it turns out, to have the other groups collaborate in that. That this dynamic of, instead of having, you can call your 911 and call the police, and at some point you realize the police is not coming to help you. The police is working with your neighbors and with the regime, the group, the organization that has decided to target you. And then many other things kick in. So, as happens in a town like Buchach and could happen in any neighborhood, if you live in a house and the house has four stories and the people upstairs have the nicest apartment and they have a piano and they're taken out by the police and shot on the street, you had nothing to do with it. You were friends. Your daughters went to school together. Now what happens to that apartment? Who is going to live there? Because if you don't move in, it's a nicer apartment, it has better air, it's a fourth floor, it has a piano, somebody else will. So you move in. And once you've moved in, well, you are already part of this process. So what you find is, and that was part of what was important for me to understand, is that on the local level, there are no simple victims, perpetrators, and bystanders. Everyone is involved in this process. Everybody gets roped in one way or another. And that veneer of civilization, of saying hello to your neighbors in the morning, suddenly disappears.
That certainly was not unique to Buchach or to the Holocaust. I mean, we've seen in the last century and even into this century other examples of this degradation and ethnic cleansing leading to just horrible outcomes for so many people. Have you given any thought to the origins of this? I mean, this is a story repeated over time, before the time of your book and after the time of your book. What is it about human nature that, are we still living in tribes on some level? Is this something you've thought about?
Yes, well, I should say that initially when I started thinking about this book, it was the 1990s, and in the 1990s, there was on the one hand a growing recognition that the Holocaust was a major event in the 20th century, which did not exist before. People forget that there wasn't the thought. And there were histories of World War II in which the Holocaust did not feature at all. Wow. So this was coming in. At the same time, there was this argument that the Holocaust was a unique event. And as that argument was beginning to spread, the genocide in the former Yugoslavia and Bosnia beginning in 1992 and the genocide in Rwanda in 1994 were happening. And I asked myself at the time, so how is that? We made all these promises after 1945, never again, right? All these monuments came up. And yet it was happening over and over again. It was happening in our own time. As the Holocaust was being recognized, other genocides were happening. Now, what is it part of human nature? Well, it has to be part of human nature because it's humans who do it. So it's obviously part of human nature, but it's not the only part of human nature. And so what is it that triggers human nature to act in this way? And I think that the most important thing is that when you identify certain groups, and you say these groups are different from those groups, these groups have rights and these groups do not, these belong here, these don't belong here, these are superior and these are inferior, and then you identify people not by who they are and what they do, but which group they belong to. Once you begin that dynamic and you have some kind of regime that is willing to take it to the end, then you will produce violence and you will produce that part of human nature in individuals that usually would not come out.
As you observe current events in this country over the last year, 2 years, do you see parallels, I guess is too strong a word, do you see these themes being presented in real time in our country in terms of people being put into categories such as what you've described?
I think that when you have a diverse society, which is made up of people who have come from all over the world, of all creeds and all colors and all backgrounds, and you begin to speak of them not as one nation, of people having the same rights, whatever their religion is, whatever their color is, and you start identifying them from the top, from the people, by the people who are supposed to be your moral leaders, as different, as dangerous, as subversive, as pernicious, then you are beginning to fray the bonds that put these societies together. And the United States, which is a remarkable society, it's the only large nation that is made up of immigrants. All other nations identify them as themselves as nation states with one nation that is the core. And the United States is one that is made up of people who came from everywhere. If you begin this process here, then the results can be disastrous, can be absolutely catastrophic. And yes, it does trouble me a great deal.
One of the lessons as a student of history myself that I've taken from the Second World War was that the world, I thought, had learned that there's a choice between pluralism and peace versus purity and violence. But that's the lesson that seems to be easily forgotten. And I'm wondering if you have given any thought to that dichotomy and our collective inability to sometimes remember some of these real fundamental lessons that seemed like we would never let go of in 1945.
Yes, you see, I mean, pluralism means different things to different people. There was a society as the one that I studied in which there were very different people living side by side. It was not a pluralistic society. It was not a multicultural society the way we would understand it. It was a society in which different groups and different religions and different ethnic groups had different socioeconomic roles, had their own culture. But they knew how to live with each other, and they did it very successfully over a long period of time. It was when they were told that they were different, and when they were told, one thing we have to understand is there's a dynamic when you start thinking about people being different, you also begin a discourse of victimhood. Mm-hmm. And you begin to say, why am I not as rich as the other group? I am the victim of that group. Why was the police after me and not after them? Because that group, my own neighbors, had denounced me, had told about me, had taken my property away. And so you begin this discourse. It's not about just pluralism. It's about finding a way of living together without identifying other groups as those who victimize you. Once you do that, you are beginning a process that's very hard to stop.
So International Holocaust Memorial Day falls on this weekend. And obviously it's a time to recall and to reflect on the Holocaust. But you're bringing a larger message, as it were, that it wasn't simply this horrible thing that took place once. To different degrees or another, this has been replicated since and was before. What is the story you'd like to bring to our audience now in terms of countering the narrative that the Holocaust was unique and it could not possibly happen anywhere else and didn't happen anywhere else? You've made a very convincing case that it does and can happen somewhere else to an extent or another.
Yes, you see, International Holocaust Memorial Day is dated January 27th because that was the day that the Auschwitz, the extermination camp Auschwitz, was liberated by the Soviets. And Auschwitz has become a symbol of the Holocaust. And Auschwitz is a symbol of part of what the Holocaust was, which was mass killing, organized, bureaucratic, in which people were taken from one place to another place and killed more or less anonymously. But half of the victims of the Holocaust didn't die in these camps. They died exactly where they lived. They died in their own streets, in their synagogues, in the creeks, in the parks, and they're still buried right there around these towns. all over Eastern Europe. To me, this is an important lesson for us to understand, because we tend to think of the Holocaust as something that is entirely different from any experience that we had or will ever have. But in fact, much of the Holocaust was a neighborhood type of violence, communal violence, in which, yes, there were some people who came from the outside, but much of what happened was within the towns themselves. And so we should look around our own neighborhoods, our own countries, and make sure that we don't identify people as such that they're different, that they have to be kicked out, that they should not be allowed in.
We have just a couple of minutes left. I'm wondering, you spent 20 years thinking about this, decade writing this book, and there's an emotional power even just to our conversation here today. I'm wondering, does that emotion affect you on a personal level as you're conducting your research, your scholarship? Do you ever have to just sort of sit down and go take a walk, or just get away from the material, because this is heavy stuff?
Yes, I mean, I've had moments like that. I mean, I remember, because I use a lot, I should say that I use hundreds of personal accounts. So there are a lot of people there. And there was a time that I used many accounts by women who were at the time girls, between the ages of 9 and 12. And at the time, my daughter was that age. And it was extremely hard for me to believe that my little girl at home could have gone through what these women had gone through when they were exactly her age. And I just had to stop. There was another moment that I realized that so many of the women that I, whose testimonies I was reading, were born in 1924. It was a coincidence. And it so happens that my mother was also born in 1924. And had she not left in 1935, she and the rest of my family that stayed behind there would have been murdered, almost certainly. And so there was a kind of very personal confrontation with that. But part of this was more than that. Part of it was really trying to see that reality through the eyes of the people who were there, not only looking at it from above as an historian, but also through the eyes and the experiences of the people who were there. And this was what made me want to continue to do that, because ultimately I wanted to tell their story.
Omer Bartov, the book is Anatomy of a Genocide. It's a remarkable piece of scholarship. Thank you for being with us. That's all the time we have this week, but if you want to know more about Storing the Public Square, you can find us on Facebook and Twitter, or visit pellcenter.org, where you can also catch up on past episodes. For G. Wayne Miller, I'm Jim Lutis, inviting you to join us again next time for more Storing the Public Square.